وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال. وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
باب لا يأتي زمان إلا والذي بعده شر منه. بخاري رحمه الله says باب chapter لا يأتي زمان. بخاري رحمه الله chapters باب chapter لا يأتي زمان إلا الذي بعده شر منه. بخاري رحمه الله then he says حدثنا. بخاري رحمه الله he says حدثنا محمد بن يوسف قال حدثنا سفيان عن الزبير بن عدي قال أتينا الأنس بن مالك فشكونا إليه ما نلقى من الحجاج فقال اصبروا فإنه لا يأتي عليكم زمان إلا الذي بعده شر منه حتى تلقوا ربكم سمعته من نبيكم. حدثنا أبو اليمان قال أخبرنا شعيب عن الزهري حا وحدثنا إسماعيل قال حدثني أخي عن سليمان عن محمد بن أبي عتيق عن ابن شهاب عن هند بنت الحارث الفراسية أن أم سلمة زوج النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قالت استيقظ رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ليلة فزعا يقول سبحان الله ماذا أنزل الله من الخزائن وماذا أنزل من الفتن من يوقظ صواحب الحجرات يريد أزواجه لكي يصلين رب كاثية في الدنيا عارية في الآخرة. Bukhari rahimullah, he said, Babun chapter, La yati zamanun, there will not come a generation or a people, illa alladhi, except that the ones who come after are worse than it. There's not going to be a people, then it's the ones that come after are worse. Then Bukhari rahimullah, he brings his evidence for this. He says, Haddathana Muhammad ibn Yusuf al-Firyabi. Qala haddathana Sufyan. Sufyan here is what? سفيان الثوري عن الزبير بن عدي الهمداني عن الزبير بن عدي الهمداني. حافظ بن حجر in his كتاب فتح الباري he mentioned something. This زبير بن عدي ابن عدي, by the way, Bukhari only narrated from him once and it's here, you're seeing it, there is, you'll never see him again. الزبير بن عدي. حافظ بن حجر mentioned that some people confuse him with الزبير بن عربي, which is also one time Bukhari rahimahullah, he narrated from Az-Zubayr ibn Arabi, he narrated from him one time, and that one time he narrated from him is in Kitab al-Hajj as well. Az-Zubayr ibn Adi, he said, Atayna, we came to Anas ibn Malik. Who did we come to? Anas ibn Malik. Imagine coming to a noble companion in a time of fitna. That's how the Salaf were. They used to come to the noble scholars and the people of knowledge. When the fitna happens, they go to them. And now we go to what? Social media. Atayna Anas ibn Malik. We came to Anas ibn Malik. Fashakawna ilayhi. We complained to him. Ma nalqa min al-hajjaji. We complained to him. From what? Fashakawna ilayhi ma yalqawna min hajjaj. By the way, the hadith has different riwayat. Different wordings. Does it say for you guys, ila ma yalqawna? فشكونا إليه ما يلقونا. يا ما نلقى. Is that what you guys have? This hadith, if you have the version that says فشكونا إليه ما نلقى من الحجاج, this is good. But if you have the other riwayah which says أتينا أنس بن مالك فشكونا إليه ما يلقونا, then he has التفات. التفات meaning they were talking about themselves and they flipped it to talking about a third person. Like in this one, seems like they carried on talking about themselves. We came to Anas ibn Malik and we complained to him. We complained about our ruler. The ruler of that time was who? Hajjaj ibn Yusuf. Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi, that's who he was. Hajjaj ibn Yusuf oppressed them, and he killed many people. They said he killed 120,000 people. Huh? How many people? That's what's known. Allahu a'lam what was hidden and he didn't tell the people about. They said he was so tyrannical, Hajjaj ibn Yusuf, so evil, that even when he died, he said, I want the people to know I died. When you take me out of my palace, after I die, take me to the graveyard, and on the way, destroy every building that goes in the way. Don't go around it. Take my body,
Don't make my body go around the buildings in order to take me to the graveyard. Destroy the buildings as you go. Destroy the building. The next one, destroy it. Take me in a khat mustaqim, a straight line, from my house to the graveyard. That's how corrupt and evil he was. I'll mention to you a story that Ibn Hajar mentioned. Listen to the story. Hafiz Ibn Hajar, he says, من طريق مجالد عن الشعبي. Of course, مجالد is فيه ضعف. He said, كان عمر فمن بعده إذا أخذوا العاصية أقاموا للناس ونزعوا عمامته. Umar ibn al-Khattab, if a person did a crime at his time, and this crime, of course, didn't reach a had, a capital punishment, and the person needs to be disciplined. And Umar wanted to discipline the person. Umar radiallahu anhu, what would he do? He will take the person and he will take the imamah off their head. The imamah mean the turban. And that was a punishment for them. Okay? It was a form of humiliation. And that was the time of Umar radiallahu anhu. That's how he used to discipline the sinners who did sins that which did not reach a had. Are we all together? There's some capital punishment. There's some things that people can do that the qadi has the right to choose the crime for that person. If you study books of fiqh, so Umar would take that person and he would take the imam off them in public, and that was a form of humiliation. فلما كان زياد when Ziyad came ضرب في الجنايات بالسياط he came and he lashed the people. He made it a bit harder. Imam wasn't working at this time, so he came and he lashed them. ثم زاد مصعب بن زبير. Mus'ab ibn Zubayr's time now, he increased on hitting them, lashing them, and of course taking the imamah off them as well, and he added on to halqul liha, shaving their beard, to humiliate them more. Because the beard is for the men, that's a sign for the men, and shaving it from them was a form of, you're not a man. فَلَمَّا كَانَ بِشْرُ بْنُ مَرْوَانِ When Bishr ibn Marwan came, سَمَّرَ كَفَّ الْجَانِي بِمِسْمَارِ When Bishr ibn Marwan came, he an hot iron rod into the person's hand. He made it even harder. فَلَمَّا قَدِمَ الْحَجَّاجِ When Hajjaj came, he said, هَذَا كُلُّهُ لُعْبٌ All of this was a joke. These people were playing around, they were joking. Anyone who does anything in my time, I will cut their head off. And he killed everybody who even he saw from them, they didn't nod to his statements. Nod. They didn't do this when he spoke. To show agreement. فَقَتَلَ بِالسَّيْفِ Hajjaj didn't wait long. He killed them. Are we all together? To the extent, one of the people that were brought to him was Sa'id ibn Jubayr. Student of Abdullah ibn Abbas was brought to him and he came into him. And then Sa'id ibn Jubayr turned towards the Qibla. He turned towards the Qibla. And then Hajjaj, why are you facing the Qibla? And he said, because it's the place where Hajjaj, he said, it's because it's the Qibla. And he said, turn him away from the Qibla. Sa'id ibn Jubayr said, فَأَيْنَمَا تُوَلُّوا فَتَمَّ وَجْهُ اللَّهِ If you turn me away from the Qibla, فَأَيْنَمَا It's an ayah. فَأَيْنَمَا تُوَلُّوا Wherever you turn me to is فَوَجْهُ اللَّهِ There is Allah's face. He said, then Hajjaj said, take his face and put it in the ground. And then Sa'id ibn Jubayr said, مِنْهَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ وَفِيهَا نُعِيدُكُمْ وَمِنْهَا نُخْرِجُكُمْ تَارَةً أُخْرَى And then Sa'id ibn Jubayr, and Hajjaj grabbed Sa'id ibn Jubayr, فَقَتَلَهُ He killed him straight away. Sa'id ibn Jubayr was killed by who? Hajjaj. The Sa'id ibn Jubayr that you read about in the books of Tafsir al-Quran, Hajjaj killed him with his own hand. He took the sword out and he killed him. Are we all together? So Hajjaj, so they came and complained about him. By the way, do you know who he killed? Abdullah ibn Zubayr, the companion. And when he hanged him, when he killed him, do you know what he did? He hanged him on the Kaaba. Hanged him on the Kaaba. This is Hajjaj ibn Yusuf. Ya'ni ikhwa, he was zalim, ja'ir. If you look at Dhahabi in Sir Alam ibn Nubala, when he talks about Hajjaj, Dhahabi gets angry about Hajjaj and who he was. So these people, they came to Anas ibn Malik. Sahabas are alive and they don't know what to do with this man. So they came to Anas ibn Malik and they complained about him. When they complained about him, they said the following to him, that Hajjaj is doing this to us and he's like this and you know what he's up to. And what did Anas ibn Malik say to them? He said, Isbiru, be patient. What did he say to them? Be patient. فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَأْتِي عَلَيْكُمْ زَمَانٌ إِلَّا الَّذِي بَعْدَهُ شَرٌّ مِّنْهُ. There's not going to come a time except the one after is going to be worse. حَتَّى تَلْقَوْ رَبَّكُمْ. Until you meet your Lord, just be patient. Now we're all together, brothers. No one looked at him and said, oh, you're a sellout. What are you saying? You work for Hajjaj, he pays you, something's wrong. Nobody said that. لِأَنَّ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ أَنَسْ بْنُ مَالِكِ. He's taking it from the evidence of the Prophet. Be patient. Just be patient. فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَأْتِي عَلَيْكُمْ زَمَانٌ. And this is the sunnah of the Salaf. قَاطِبَةً. Al-Imam Ahmad was arrested for the issue of the Qur'an being created. And when he was taken, Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he was put in prison. And Ahmad was lashed. He was lashed so much, the leader came down himself and lashed him. Hate that he had for Ahmad. And you know what Ahmad said? Ahmad said that the leader didn't have to lock me in a cage. And he didn't have to put the chains on me. Wallahi, if he left the doors of the prison opened and he didn't put chains on me, wallahi, I wouldn't leave the prison until he tells me to leave. I would listen and I would obey him. Ahmad ibn Hanbal is saying this. I wouldn't leave. I'd stay in my prison. I'd stay where I was told to stay. There's no need for them to chain me. Lakin, I don't believe the Quran is created. Huh? Lakin, as-sam'u wa ta'a. Obey. Listen. Are we all together? Ahmad ibn Hanbal, they saw him after he came out of prison. They saw him. The people saw Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Yad'u lil amir, making dua for him. And they said, why are you making dua for him? And he said, bitanat as-su. Evil people were around him. The people around him are very evil people. They misguided him and took him away from the concept that the Quran is the speech of Allah. And it's true, Ahmad ibn Du'adin and Bishr al-Mirisi and Thumamat ibn Ashras, these were the people that were around Al-Ma'mun that was convincing him that the Quran is created. He didn't know. Are we all together? The reason, wallahi, brothers, you have to understand is that don't take a personal issue. This is what the Salaf were looking at. The fitna that these people were going through was personal. It was ashkhas mu'ayyaneen that the leader was hurting. But when they go against him, fayya'ummul fitna. The fitna is not going to be restricted to a particular group of people. It's going to go to who? Every single person. He's going to bring his army. He's going to fight back. He's going to try to fight his position. He won't give up. The bloodshed and whatever you were saying was a problem then is going to now become 20 times worse. And that's what Ahmad ibn Hanbal used to say, and Hassan al-Basri, ad-dima, ad-dima. Hassan al-Basri specifically, when they came to him and they had their swords ready and they said, we're going to go against Hajjaj. Fasiq, zalim, ja'ir. What did he say? Ad-dima, ad-dima, blood, blood, blood. This imma, they can see this. And you know what they said to Hassan al-Basri when he said that? He said, he's not even an Arab. What does he know? Are we all together? Yani, this concept of insulting the scholar as much as they give you a verdict that doesn't go in line with you is shay'un ma'ruf. Rather, go to the Kitab al-I'tisam by Imam al-Shatibi. Go to it. Kitab al-I'tisam by Shatibi. Shatibi died in the 5th century. Go to his Kitab al-I'tisam. It is mentioned in there that a man said, مَا عِلْمُ مُحَمَّدِ ibn Sirin wa Malik wa Shafi'i. What is the knowledge of Muhammad ibn Sirin? And al-Imam Malik and al-Imam Shafi'i and these Imams, what is their knowledge? إِلَّا حَيْضَ مُلْقَات. Only they know only menses. Their knowledge is أحكام الحيض والنفاس. That's all they know. That's the knowledge that al-Imam Malik and Muhammad ibn is mawjood fi Kitab al-I'tisam. That the Khawarij of that time were saying that. So it's Shay, they've taken it from one another. So Anas ibn Malik said, be patient, do not go against him, because wallahi, what's going to come later is worse. What you're thinking is bad now, what's going to come is worse. This hadith, it became a problem to some of the scholars. In the sense, they couldn't understand it properly. Not that they didn't accept it. Of course, they accept the hadith, but the understanding became a bit ishkal. A bit of problem occurred from it, which is Hajjaj was a tyrannical person, correct? He was, right? An evil person. Who came after him? Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was after Hajjaj. So if we take this hadith, لا يأتي زمان إلا والذي بعده شر منه, that there does not come a generation except the one that comes after it is worse. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz's time, by unanimous agreement, was better than the time of Hajjaj. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz's time, his time, they couldn't find a person to give the sadaqah to. People were rich enough and happy. There was no one to give the sadaqah to. Hafidh ibn Hajar, and he says, look what he says. إِنَّ الشَّرَّ إِضْمَحَلَّ فِي زَمَانِ Umar ibn Abdul Aziz's time, the fitna of Hajjaj actually fully perished. No fitna was left. The time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. لِمَا كَانَ بَعِيدًا فَصْلًا عَنْ أَنْ يَكُونَ شَرًّا مِنَ الزَّمَانِ الَّذِي قَبْلَهُ Let alone it being worse than it. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, by unanimous agreement, his time was better than the time of Hajjaj. And Umar ibn Abdul Aziz came after Hajjaj. So how do we reconcile this hadith with the reality that we see here? صح? So this became an ishkal for some scholars. There are two explanations, write it down. The first explanation is the explanation of Hassan al-Basri. Hassan al-Basri, you said that this is al al-akthar al-aghlabi. This is the overwhelming majority of the times that the overwhelming majority of times, there doesn't come a generation except the one after it is worse. Majority of the times, that's the situation. And there are exceptions, like this issue of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz and Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi. That's the view of Hassan al-Basri. And he even argued and he said that la budda lin-nasi min tanfisin. Ah. He said sometimes when the fitna is going on, Allah gives the people tanfis, a time to relax and breathe. The fitna can't just go on. And at the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, Allah was giving them that tanfis. Okay. This view is very good, but it's not the strongest view. The second view is the strongest. And the second view is, Hajjaj's time is better than the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. How? Hajjaj ibn Yusuf's time, the Sahabas were more in number and they were alive. And the time where the Sahabas are alive is not equal to the time when they are not alive. Okay? The knowledge was more at the time of Hajjaj. The time of the knowledge was more. And the knowledge decreased in a comparison to the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. And this is the statement of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. So we're going to have to take it because he's a noble companion. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said, Hafidh ibn Hajr, he said, ثُمَّ وَجَدْتُ عَنْ عَبْدِ اللَّهِ بِنِ مَسْعُودِنَا التَّصْرِيحَ بِالْمُرَادِ وَهُوَ أَوْلَى بِالْاتِّبَاعِ Hafidh ibn Hajr said, we have to take the statement of Ibn Mas'ud. أَوْلَى بِالْاتِّبَاعِ The second view is Abdullah ibn Mas'ud's view. فَأَخْرَجْ يَعْقُوبُ بْنُ شَيْبَةَ مِنْ طَرِيقِ الْحَارِثِ بْنُ حَصْرِيَّةٍ حصيرة sorry عن زيد بن وهب قال سمعت عبد الله بن مسعود يقول I heard عبد الله بن مسعود say لا يأتي عليكم يوم إلا وهو شر من الذي قبل كان قبله There's not a day except that the day after is going to be worse حتى تقوم الساعة until the hour comes لست أعني عبد الله بن مسعود said I don't mean رقاء من العيش يصيبه I don't mean that you're going to have nice rain crops good money I'm not going to mean that. وَلَا مَالًا يُفِيدُ And I don't mean wealth that's going to increase. No. وَلَكِنْ لَا يَأْتِي عَلَيْكُمْ يَوْمٌ X. But what I mean is, there will not come a day إِلَّا وَهُوَ أَقَلُّ عِلْمًا مِنَ الْيَوْمِ الَّذِي مَضَى قَبْلَهُ Except that the knowledge is less than the day that came before it. فَإِذَا ذَهَبَ الْعُلَمَاءُ When the scholars go, إِسْتَوَى النَّاسُ The people become equal. فَلَا يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ So the people will not command each other, nor prohibit each other from evil. وَلَا يَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ فَعِنْدَ ذَلِكَ يَهْلَكُونَ And then the destruction comes. So at the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, the Sahabas were not in number like they were what? The time of Hajjaj. Okay? Or the knowledge more like at the time of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz was not the time of Hajjaj. There was more knowledge at that time. There was not much knowledge at the time of Umar Abdul Aziz in comparison to Hajjaj's time. Does that make sense? Then, brothers, the presence of the scholars and the people of knowledge is a ni'mah. What is it? It's a ni'mah. And their existence in our midst is a ni'mah. That's what Allah said in the ayah, أَوَلَمْ يَرَوْا أَنَّا نَأْتِي الْأَرْضَ نَنْقُصُهَا مِنْ أَطْرَافِهَا. Do you not see that we will take away from the earth and we will take from it? Some of the mufassirin, they said, taking from the earth means ذِهَابُ عُلَمَائِكُمْ وَفُقَهَائِكُمْ. Ibn Abbas and Mujahid ibn Jabrin said that. Are we all together? Allah will take from this earth the people of knowledge and those understanding. And when they go, that's when it becomes more fasad and fitan. حدثنا أبو اليمان قال أخبرنا شعيب عن الزهري حاء وقال حدثنا إسماعيل حدثني أخي عن سليمان عن محمد بن أبي عتيق عن ابن شهاب عن هند بنت الحارث الفراسية أن أم سلمة زوج النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قالت استيقظ رسول الله. أم سلمة, she said the prophet woke up ليلة فزعا. The prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he woke up one night فزعا. He woke up sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, fazi'. Fazi' means he was shaken, alayhi salatu wa salam, when he woke up. And then he said, Subhanallah, exalted is Allah. Mada anzal Allahu min al-khazain. The treasures Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent. So the mada here is istifhamun bima'na ta'ajjub. As Ibn Hajar mentioned, it's not a question, it's ta'ajjub. The Prophet is fascinated. مَاذَا أَنزَلَهُ. What Allah has sent down to you, amazed with it. من الخزائن. The treasures. The treasures here mean, يَا اللَّهُ تَبَارَكْ وَتَعَالَى, He brought for the people the Romans and the Persians' treasures. The Muslims, they, after the Prophet's time, they took over Rome and Persia and all these lands. فُتُوحَات. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying in hadith, these treasures are going to be in the hands of the Muslims. A lot of it is going to be open. Then look what he said. وَمَا أُنزِلَ مِنَ الْفِتَنِ. But there's fitna with it. The money that came, the treasures, the opening and the conquests, the conquering of lands, it brought about fitan, trials and tribulations. Look what Ibn Hajar said, rahimahullah. He said, قال ابن بطال, ابن حجر, he said, ابن بطال, he said, في هذا الحديث أن الفتوح في الخزائن تنشأ عنه فتنة المال بأن يتنافس فيه فيقع القتال بسببه وأن يبخل به فيمنع الحق أو يبطر صاحبه فيصرف. حافظ ابن حجر brings the statement of ابن بطال. The people, they get money, treasures, gold, the people get rich. What happens? تنشأ عنه فتنة المال. Then the fitna of wealth comes from this. يَتَنَافَسُ فِي. The people start competing with one another. Enmity, hasad, hate, that starts coming. فَيَقَعُ الْقِتَالِ. And they start killing each other, murdering each other. Are we all together? That's what they do. بِسَبَبِ, because of that. وَأَنْ يُبَخَلَ. And some people become stingy. I want to make more money. If I give this money out, بُخُل. That he doesn't want to pay the zakat from it. فَيُمْنَعُ الْحَقُ. The haq that should have been paid from the money won't be paid. أَوْ يُبْطَرَ. أو يبطر صاحبه, or the person becomes arrogant, بطر, full of himself, because of the wealth that he has. فأراد صلى الله عليه وسلم, so the Prophet intended from this, تحذير أزواجه, to warn his wives. من ذلك كله وكذلك غيرهن ممن بلغه ذلك. And he was warning everyone else. Look what the Prophet said after that. He said to his wives, after he said that the treasures are going to be open and the people are going to get wealth, he said, من يوقظ صواحب الحجرات. Who's going to wake up my wives in their chambers? Who's going to wake them up? يريد أزواجه لكي يصلين, so they can pray. Who's going to wake up my wives right now so that they can stand up and pray? رب كاسية في الدنيا عارية في الآخرة. رب, there's a faida I came across regarding رب. رب in the Arabic language, is it used for التقليل or is it used for التكثير? رب, does it mean a lot or does it mean little? Huh? Hafidh ibn Hajr is of the opinion that the word rubba, it's used for at-takthir, when something is large. He said, ابن مالك من أن رب أكثر ما ترد للتكثير، فإنه قال أكثر النحويين أن إنها للتقليل، وأن معنى ما يصدر بها المضي، والصحيح أن معناها في الغالب التكثير، وهو مقتضى كلام سيبويه، فإنه قال في باب كم: واعلم أن كم في الخبر لا تعمل إلا فيما تعمل فيه رب، لأن المعنى واحد، إلا أن كم اسم ورب غير اسم. انتهى كلامه. The word رب that the prophet used here means a lot. A lot. And the evidence that he brought from it is this view of Ibn Malik. And even Sibawayhi. Sibawayhi has a kitab. He's got a book. It's called Kitab. Sibawayhi, he brought Rubba under the chapter of the Kam al-Khabariya. And the Kam al-Khabariya, according to the Nuhat, it shows al-Takthir. And so Sibawayhi and Ibn Malik are of the same opinion. What do I mean by this? What I mean by this is رُبَّ a lot are people dressed in this dunya, and the day of judgment they're going to be naked. رُبَّ here means a lot are people going to be dressed كَاثِيَةٍ فِي الدُّنْيَا, you're clothed in this dunya, عَارِيَةً فِي الْآخِرَةِ, and they're going to be naked the day of judgment. What does that mean? What does that mean? This is the question that some of the scholars spoke about. What does it mean? A lot is the people going to be dressed the day of judgment, and they're going to be naked. They're going to be dressed in this dunya, and they're going to be naked the day of judgment. Some of the scholars, they said it means the woman who dresses up, she wears clothes, she's not covering her awrah properly. She's not covering herself properly. رُبَّ كَاسِيَةٍ, she's wearing clothes. You can't say she's not wearing clothes. But the clothes has two problems. First of all, it's showing her body parts. Or it's too tight on her. And it's showing her figure. رُبَّ كَاسِيَةٍ, a lot are those women dressed with clothing. And عَارِيَةً, but they're really naked. They are really what? They are really naked. Some of the scholars, they took that opinion. Some scholars, they took the opinion, رُبَّ كَاسِيَةٍ فِي الدُّنْيَا, it means dressed with ibadat today, but the day of judgment, they are stripped from its reward. They are doing what they are doing right now, dressing and adorning themselves with righteous actions. But the truth of it is that it's not going to be righteous actions عند الله يوم القيامة, because it misses the conditions of what? It misses the condition of either al-ikhlas or following the sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. This hadith showed us when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم spoke about the fitan and the trials and tribulation, what did he say? He said, who's going to wake up what? Who's going to wake up my wives? So they can do what? Ibadah. The times of fitna, ibadah is what we run to. Al-Qiyam, standing at night, praying to Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, worshipping Him, and fasting the days. And I mentioned the famous hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, where he said, Al-ibadatu fil harji kahijratin ilayya. The ibadah that is done at the time of fitan is like hijrah to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And Imam al-Bukhari, he then said, باب قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من حمل علينا السلاح فليس منا. قال حدثنا عبد الله بن يوسف قال أخبرنا مالك عن نافع عن عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من حمل علينا السلاح فليس منا. قال حدثنا محمد بن العلاء قال حدثنا أبو أسامة عن بريد عن أبي بردة عن أبي مسعود أبي موسى عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من حمل علينا السلاح فليس منا. قال حدثنا محمد قال أخبرنا عبد الرزاق عن معمر عن همنام سمعت أبا هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لا يشير أحدكم على أخيه بالسلاح فإنه لا يدري لعل الشيطان ينزغ في يده فيقع في حفرة من النار. حدثنا علي بن عبد الله قال حدثنا سفيان قال قلت لعمر يا أبا محمد سمعت جابر بن عبد الله يقول مر رجل بسهام في المسجد فقال له رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أمسك بنصالها قال نعم قال حدثنا أبو النعمان قال حدثنا حماد بن زيد عن عمرو بن دينار عن جابر أن رجلا مر في المسجد بأسهم قد أبدى نصولها فأمر أن يأخذ بنصولها لا يخدش مسلما قال حدثنا محمد بن العلاء قال حدثنا أبو أسامة عن بريد عن أبي بردة عن أبي مسعود عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إذا مر أحدكم في مسجدنا أو في سوقنا ومعه نبل فليمسك على نصالها أو قال فليقض بكفه أن يصيب أحدا من المسلمين منها شيء Bukhari here, he says, he brought the chapter, Man hamala, anyone who carries alayna on the ummah of Muhammad, carries a weapon on them, falaysa minna, he's not from us. What does it mean from he's not from amongst us? It either means he's a kafir, or it means that he's a what? He's a sinner. He's a kafir if he believes it's halal to kill the Muslims. If he believes it's halal for me to go and kill and spill blood, then he becomes a kafir because he is making halal for himself, something Allah tabarak wa ta'ala made haram, and its prohibition is known by what? By necessity of the religion of Islam. So this is ridda an deen al-Islam. Okay? So anyone who makes halal for himself, something that the religion made haram, and its prohibition is known in the religion by necessity, this person will leave the religion. And he is kufrun akbar. So that's one view. By saying, man hamala alayna al-silaha istihlalan lahu, falaysa minna, he's not from us, meaning he's a disbeliever. The second one is, it's not referring to a person who is seeing it to be halal. He believes what he's doing is wrong, but he just wants to revenge. Or he's doing it for worldly issues. Then this person is not a disbeliever, but he's a what? He's doing a major sin. He's doing a what? Major sin, and the following is gonna be for him, which is قوله تعالى ومن يقتل مؤمنا متعمدا فجزاؤه جهنم خالدا فيها وغضب الله عليه ولعنه وأعد له عذابا عظيما. Allah says ومن يقتل مؤمنا, anyone who kills a believer, متعمدا, deliberately, فَجَزَأُ, his reward is what? جَهَنَّمُ. جَهَنَّمُ is your number one. Write that down. You're in جَهَنَّمُ. خَالِدًا, you're going to stay there forever. فِيهَا, in جَهَنَّمُ. وَغَضِبَ اللَّهُ, number three, Allah is going to be angry with you severely. وَلَعَنَهُ, and Allah has distanced His mercy from you. وَأَعَدَّ لَهُ, and Allah has prepared for you عَذَابًا عَظِيمًا, a severe punishment. Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said إِنَّهُ لَا تَوْبَةَ لَهُ, إِنَّهُ لَا تَوْبَةَ لَهُ, he has no repentance. And the person you killed will come the day of judgment and he will say سِلْ لِمَا قَتَلَنِ, like, why did this man kill me? Ask him, my Lord, why did this person kill me? For what did I do? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a famous hadith, the Prophet said, وَلَنْ يَزَالَ الْمُؤْمِنُ فِي فُصْحَةٍ مِنْ دِينِهِ مَا لَمْ يُصِبْ دَمًا حَرَامًا. The person will be in his religion with joy and simplicity and ease as long as he's not spilled the blood of a believer. If you have spilled the blood of a person deliberately, it's an evil act. Wallahi, it's an evil act. Killing a Muslim, taking the life of a Muslim, is not a joke. Rather, this is how severe it is. Usama ibn Zayd, a noble companion, was in the middle of a battlefield. He saw a man take a sword, and he was striking the people and killing them and making a line. And Usama came walking to the man, and the man said, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Pay attention to this. We all know when we have to give da'wah to a person to take Islam, it takes weeks, months, maybe days, maybe even hours to convince them, say, brother, this is the religion of Islam. Okay, let me go home and think about it. Sah. It takes time. Convincing takes time. This person is killing the Muslims. And Usama comes and he sees Usama and he says, Ashhadu la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. at Usama, strikes and kills him. What does it look from the apparent? It looks like he's running away. And that's what Usama didn't want him to let go of him. And Usama striked him. What did Usama ibn Zayd do? He striked his neck and killed him. Then Usama came to the Prophet and the issue was brought to the Prophet. Then the Messenger said, أَقَتَلْتَهُ بَعْدَ أَنْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ Usama, did you kill him after he said, لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ He said, قَالَ هَارِبًا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ He said it because he ran away from me. The Prophet said, أَقَتَلْتَهُ بَعْدَ أَنْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ Did you kill him after he said, لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ And he said, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ He was running away. And then the Prophet ﷺ, he said, أَفَلَا شَقَقْتَ عَنْ قَلْبِهِ Why didn't you open his chest and see if he was saying it because he was running away? What would you do the day of judgment when La ilaha illallah comes to you, Usama, and it holds you account for what you did? Usama ibn Zayd said, that day, I wished I came into Islam that day. وَلِذَلِكَ when the issue happened between Muawiyah and Ali, Usama ran away from this whole issue. He learnt it. And وَلِذَلِكَ Ali ibn Abi Talib was sending some gifts to people, he told his children, don't give the gift to Usama. Ali was hurt by Usama, that he wasn't with him. He didn't help him. He said, don't give anything to Usama. Are we all together? It's going to come to us in Kitab al-Fitan. It's going to come to us. And he said, don't give it to him. And Usama said, Wallahi, Ali is beloved to me. If Ali ibn Abi Talib, if he entered the mouth of a lion, I would go in it with him. Usama say this, but I'm not going to spill the blood of a believer. After what I learned from the Prophet ﷺ, I'm never going to spill the blood of a believer. Are you with me, brothers? So killing today and taking the life of a person is easy. Just kill him, get rid of him. Bomb this place, do this. And thousands of people are dying. The day of judgment, those people will be questioned amam Allah Ta'ala yawm al-qiyamah. They can give themselves every excuses they want, they can bring every evidence that they want the day of judgment, that won't change the haqa'iq and the reality. They will be questioned the day of judgment, those people's blood they spilt. They will be questioned. It's a very serious issue. Brothers, this hadith did not say the one who kills the people is not from amongst us. What did it say? The person who carries a weapon for us, not uses it. It didn't say use it. It says man hamala, the person who just carries it. Hafidh ibn Hajar brought the aqwal of some of the scholars that even if you point a weapon at a brother and you're joking, falaysa minna, you enter here. You're joking, brother. Huh? You scare him with a knife. He's your little brother, so you scare him with a knife. You will fall under this hadith, man hamala alayna as-silaha. Anyone who carries a weapon for us, man hamala alayna as-silaha, falaysa minna. Dangerous. The riwayah mentions, la yushiru ahadukum. Do not point your weapon ala akhihi, your brother. Do not point the weapon at your brother. Bis-silahi, fa innahu la yadri, because you don't know. La'alla ash-shaytana yanzighu fi yadi. Shaytan might push you from the back. فَيَقَعُ فِي حُفْرَةٍ مِنَ النَّارِ And then you fall into a pit of fire. Be careful. You're playing around. And in my culture, they even say it in my language that the shaitan is pushing it from the back. Your sword and the blade. They took it from this hadith. Don't play around with it. Don't joke around with a weapon. So what do we do? How do we carry the sword? How do we carry a knife that we took from the kitchen that we want to? How should we carry it? The Prophet mentions it here. حدثنا علي بن عبد الله قال حدثنا سفيان قال قلت لعمر يا أبا محمد سمعت جابر بن عبد الله يقول مر رجل بسهام في المسجد A man walked by the masjid of the Prophet with a sword. فقال له رسول الله The Messenger said أمسك بنصالها Grab the front of the blade with your hand. Grab the part, the sharp end with your hand. قال نعم the man said oh, yes of course حدثنا أبو نعيم قال حدثنا حماد بن زيد أبو نعيم he said عن عمر بن دينار عن جابر أن رجلا مر في المسجد بأسهم قد أبدى نصولها. The man, he had either a sword or he had arrows. فأمر أن يأخذ بنصولها لا يخدش مسلما. Why is he told to cover the sharp end of the blade or the sharp end of the arrows? The reason is لا يخدش مسلما. The word يخدش means scratch. So he doesn't scratch a Muslim. Scratching a Muslim is not right. Let alone killing a Muslim. The Prophet, look what he's preventing you from doing. Don't do that.
حدثنا محمد بن العلاء قال حدثنا أبو أسامة عن بريد عن أبي بردة عن أبي موسى عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال إذا مر أحدكم في مسجدنا أو في سوقنا ومعه نبل فليمسك على نصالها.
If you're going in the market and you're carrying a weapon, a sword, a blade, an arrow, cover the, hold the part that is the sharp end, hold it. Ha. فليقضي بكفيه. Ha. Cover it with your hand. أو أن يصيب أحد من المسلمين منها شيء.
Because it could happen that you can harm the believers, the Muslims.
You could what? You can harm and cause the Muslims problems.
باب قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا ترجعوا بعدي كفارا يضرب بعضكم رقاب بعض. قال حدثنا عمر بن حفص قال حدثنا أبي حدث قال حدثنا الأعمش قال حدثنا شقيق قال قال عبد الله قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم سباب المسلم فسوق وقتال كفر. قال حدثنا حجاج بن منهان قال حدثنا شعبة قال أخبرني واقد بن أبي محمد عن أبي عن ابن عمر أنه سمع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول أنه سمع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول لا ترجعوا بعدي كفارا يضرب بعضكم رقاب بعض. قال حدثنا مسدد قال حدثنا يحيى قال حدثنا قرة بن خالد قال حدثنا ابن سيرين عن عبد الرحمن بن أبي بكرة عن أبي بكرة وعن رجل آخر هو أفضل في نفسه من عبد الرحمن بن أبي بكرة عن أبي بكرة أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم خطب الناس فقال ألا تدرون أي يوم هذا؟ قالوا الله ورسوله أعلم. قال حتى ظننا أنه سيسميه بغير اسمه فقال أليس بيوم النحر؟ قلنا بلى يا رسول الله. قال أي بلد هذا؟ أليست بالبلدة؟ قلنا بلى يا رسول الله. قال فإن دماءكم وأموالكم وأعراضكم وأبشاركم عليكم حرام كحرمة يومكم هذا في شهركم هذا في بلدكم هذا، ألا هل بلغت؟ قلنا نعم. قال اللهم اشهد فليبلغ الشاهد الغائب فإنه رب مبلغ فإنه رب مبلغ يبلغه من هو أوعى له. فكان كذلك. قال لا ترجعوا بعدي كفارا يضرب بعضكم رقاب بعض. فلما كان يوم حرق ابن الحضرمي حين حرقه جارية ابن قدامة قال أشرفوا على أبي بكرة. فقالوا هذا أبو بكرة يراك. قال عبد الرحمن فحدثتني أمي عن أبي بكرة أنه قال لو دخلوا علي ما بهشت بقصبة. قال حدثنا أحمد بن إشكاب قال حدثنا محمد بن فضيل عن أبيه عن عكرمة عن ابن عباس رضي الله تعالى عنهما قال قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا ترتدوا بعدي كفارا يضرب بعضكم رقاب بعض. قال حدثنا سليمان بن حرب قال حدثنا شعبة عن علي بن مدرك قال سمعت أبا زرعة بن عمرو بن جرير عن جده جرير قال لي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في حجة الوداع استنصت الناس ثم قال لا ترجعوا بعدي كفارا يضرب بعضكم رقاب بعض. بخاري رحمه الله he mentions the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم where he said do not go on your heels after me and become disbelievers, smacking each other's necks, killing one another. The Prophet said to the Sahabas, after me, do not become disbelievers, killing one another. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said. Then the author, rahimahullah, he brought this statement of Amr ibn Hafsin. He brought the statement of Amr ibn Hafsin wa ibn Ghayathin. Qala hadathani Abi, his father is Hafs ibn Ghayathin. Qala hadathani al-A'mash, Sulaiman ibn Mihran. An Shaqiq, Abi Wa'ilin. Qala Abdullah ibn Mas'udin. Sibabul Muslim. Insulting a Muslim is a what? Fusuq. Wa qitalu and killing the Muslim is a what?
كفر. فسوق, what does it mean in the Arabic language? والفسوق في لغة العرب الخروج. It's to leave something. Which one is worse? The word فسوق or the word عصيان? Which one is worse? فسوق is worse than عصيان. Benefit. Many people don't ponder this نكتة لطيفة إن شاء الله تعالى. The word فسق is worse than عصيان. And the evidence for that is Allah تبارك وتعالى على سبيل التدلي من الأعلى إلى الأدنى, he mentioned it in سورة الحجرات when he said وكره إليكم الكفر, which is the highest, والفسوق, which is level, next level, والعصيان, which is lower. إذن عصيان is lower than what? الفسوق. فسوق is higher. عصيان is lower. كفر is the highest. And the hadith, what did he do here? The hadith here, killing the Muslim is what? كفر. Insulting the Muslim is what? فسق. And it's higher than عصيان. Now we all together. It's higher than عصيان. How do we reconcile that with the famous hadith of the Prophet ﷺ where he said, لعن المؤمن كقتله. Insulting the believer is like killing him. If we just said killing is kufr, and insulting is what? Yeah? Is fusuq. Then this hadith says, insulting the Muslim is what? Killing him. Huh? How do we reconcile between that? What we say is, the way to reconcile this between, or the way to reconcile this with this one is that, not everything that's compared to each other, they are the same with each other in all angles. Even that the Prophet said, لَعْنُ الْمُؤْمِنِ insulting the mu'min or cursing the mu'min is like killing him, it doesn't mean from all angles. It means that both of them are very serious acts. Are we all together? And the evidence for that is the famous hadith where the Prophet ﷺ, his revelation was compared to a what? The hadith of Aisha in Kitab al-Badi al-Wahi, the beginning of Sahih al-Bukhari, it was compared to what? The bell. Like the revelation when it came to the Prophet, it was like a what? It's like a bell. Does that mean that the revelation and the bell are the same? It doesn't mean when you compare two things, it doesn't mean you're comparing something from all angles. Because the bell is something different to the revelation without a shadow of a doubt. ولذلك the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said in a hadith, لا تصحب الملائكة رفقة فيها كلب ولا جرس. The angels, they don't enter a house where there is a dog in it or a what? A bell. And I want to mention a benefit here, which is some people, they live in households where there is a bell. When you ring their house, what does it do? When you ring the bell, you call it bell, right? The house, inside their house is a what? The angels won't enter that house. The angels do not enter. So one of the things that you do is just change the bell. Make it a noise that's not a bell. Okay? Does that make sense? Some people, they have noises like, Subhanallah. Hello, no problem. When you ring their bell, it's Subhanallah. Or some people, it's the noise of birds. Yeah? Things like that, do it like that. Don't make it a jaras, a bell. And some people, in the masjid, they bring their phones and it has a what? Bell. It's a what? It's a bell. So we have to be careful of that. It was a side benefit that I wanted to point out. Don't go to other people's houses and start destroying their bell system. Just your own household, inshallah. Change it, inshallah. Change it. Just make another noise for you to know. Huh? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said in the hadith, "Sibabul Muslim, insulting the Muslim is fusuqun, is transgression. Wa qitalu, and killing him is what? Killing him is kufrun. Killing him is a what? Kufrun." قال الإمام البخاري, he said, حدثنا حجاج بن ملهان. حجاج بن ملهان البصري. قال حدثنا شعبة وهو ابن الحجاج أبو بسطام العتكي. أخبرني واقد وهو ابن محمد بن زيد بن عبد الله بن عمر بن عمر بن الخطاب عن أبيه محمد بن زيد عن جده عبد الله بن عمر أنه سمع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول في حجة الوداع عند جمرة العقبة. The Prophet ﷺ said in حجة الوداع next to the Jamratul Aqaba, the Prophet said, لا ترجعوا حجة الوداع. The last sermon, the largest congregation of people came. The Prophet said to them, he said, don't turn on your heels killing one another. That's what he said. So the people here, why? Some scholars, they said, does this hadith show that if you kill one another, you're a kafir? No, it doesn't. Because Allah says, وَإِن طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اقْتَتَلُوا. If two parties of the believers kill one another, and Allah referred to both parties as what? Believers. Here, what it means is that killing one another over worldly issues and just killing each other like that is the actions of the disbelievers. Muslims don't just kill people. That's what it means. لا ترجع بعدي كفارا يضرب بعضكم رقاب بعض. Okay. Then Bukhari rahimahullah, he said, حدثنا مسدد قال حدثنا يحيى. يحيى هي يحيى بن سعيد القطان. قال حدثنا قرة بن خالد السدوسي قال حدثنا ابن سيرين عن عبد الرحمن بن أبي بكرة عن أبي بكرة نفيع بن الحارث الثقفي وعن رجل آخر هو أفضل في نفسه من عبد الرحمن بن أبي بكرة عن أبي بكرة. Here, there's something shocking here. Very shocking that touched me. Really shocking. Look at the hadith, everyone. And I'm going to conclude with this hadith, inshallah ta'ala. And we'll take questions from the people. Look at what this hadith says. Hadith says, Abi Bakr Nufay' ibn Harith al-Thaqafi, he said, the narration says, وَعَنْ رَجُلٍ آخَرَ. Another man narrated this hadith. هو أفضل في نفسه من عبد الرحمن بن أبي بكرة عن أبي بكرة أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم خطب الناس فقال. Who is this man in the narration which is mentioned? وعن رجل أي man آخر another man هو أفضل is better to me in my own self than عبد الرحمن بن أبي بكرة. Meaning, this man is better than Abd al-Rahman ibn Abi Bakr, who is the son of a companion. This man is Humayd ibn Abd al-Rahman al-Himyari. Why is the narration mentioned that he is better than the narration that Bukhari chose here? Why is Humayd ibn Abd al-Rahman al-Himyari better than who? Abd al-Rahman ibn Abi Bakr Nufay' ibn Harith al-Thaqafi. The reason is because Abd al-Rahman ibn Abi Bakr Nufay' ibn Harith al-Thaqafi, he took positions. When you take positions and you open yourself to the dunya, your level reduces. And I want to mention a benefit here. This is the benefit I wanted to mention. The benefit here is, Al-Imam Muslim narrated in his Sahih, that a group of people came to Abdullah ibn Umar. Please listen to this. If you didn't listen to the whole lecture, just listen to this benefit. قَدْ سَأَلَ رَجُّنُ ibn Umar. A man came and he asked Ibn Umar a question. And he said, this is the question he put to him. He said, "Atufu bil bayti." I'm going to do. I'm doing tawaf around the Kaaba. وَقَدْ أَحْرَمْتُ بِالْحَجِّ. And I'm in a state of ihram for Hajj. Can I do tawaf around the Kaaba? That's my question. I'm here for Hajj. Can I go around the Kaaba and do tawaf? Abdullah ibn Umar, and he said, "وَمَا يَمْنَعُكَ? What's stopping you?" قَالَ. He said, "رَأَيْتُ I saw ibn Fulanin. I saw so-and-so, يَكْرَهُ وَأَنْتَ أَحَبُّ إِلَيْنَا مِنْهُ. That so-and-so, he dislikes it. But you, Ibn Umar, is more beloved to us than that individual. I'll tell you who that individual is. قَدْ فَتَنَهُ الدُّنْيَا. That person, the dunya has become his fitna. فَقَالَ Abdullah Ibn Umar, in then say, knowing who the person that's been spoken about, he knows who it is. He said, وَأَيُّنَا, أو أَيُّكُمْ, which of you, لَمْ تَفْتِنْهُ الدُّنْيَا, who from amongst you that the dunya did not become a fitna for him. ثُمَّ قَالَ. Then he said to the person who was asking the question, رَأَيْنَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. The messenger did tawaf around the Kaaba whilst he was in a state of ihram, and he even went to Safa and Marwa. So you can do it, there's no problem in that issue. And we follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Is that, that's what he said. Do you know who the person they were saying, he doesn't like it, he doesn't like it, and he dislikes it because the dunya has become his fitna, and you, Abdullah ibn Umar, is more beloved to us? Is Abdullah ibn Abbas. The person they're talking about is who? Abdullah ibn Abbas. This is a mas'ala, it requires looking, which is The fatwa of an alim or a person, a talibu ilm, goes low when he opens himself to the dunya. Becoming a person, your day dana, your whole entire life revolves around dunya, money, 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 that you will lose your akhirah for it. Or even slightly opens. Abdullah ibn Abbas. Lakin ibn Umar ab'adu an-nas 'an ad-dunya. He was the furthest from the dunya. Are we all together? Abdullah ibn Umar refused in manasib, he refused positions, he refused qada, he refused everything. Are we all together, brothers? This is the same thing here in this hadith right now, that Abdurrahman ibn Abi Bakrah is a non-honorable man. His father is a companion. Lakin the reason why Humayd ibn Abdurrahman al-Himiri was given more is because he was a zahid. And the minute the dunya enters you, people are scared there may be an ulterior motive. There may be a what? An ulterior motive. So this is something that we need to take into consideration and understand. This hadith, what does it show us? This hadith, what does it show us? It shows that the Prophet ﷺ asked them a question. He said, أَلَا تَدْرُونَ حَجَّةِ الْوَدَاعِ. The Prophet was talking to the people and he said to them, أَلَا تَدْرُونَ أَيُّ يَوْمٍ هَذَا. Do you not know this day? The Prophet wanted to talk to the companions. He said, do you guys know what day is today? And the Sahabas, they slightly got taken off. They slightly got shocked. Because remember, when somebody asks you something that's very obvious, you start thinking there might be a tricky answer to it. So the Sahabas, they said, Allah wa Rasulu A'lam. Allah and His Messenger know. They thought he was going to say, if anybody asks you a very obvious question, you're always like, most likely you're not going to give the right answer because you're taken off balance. Like, what's my name? He's your brother and he goes, what's your name? Yeah, my name. Huh. Well, my name. You can't answer it quickly. You need to think because you're worried about what is it that he's asking, why is he asking, what is the logic behind it? So the Sahabas, when they were asked this question, they were taken off and they said, Allah wa Rasulu A'lam. Allah and His Messenger know. قال حتى ظننا أنه سيسميه بغير اسمه. Because we thought he was going to say something else. فقال أليس بيوم النحر. Today is not the day of نحر, the day of the slaughter. قلنا بلى يا رسول. We said, of course it is. I mean, we know it. Then the Prophet said, أي بلد هذا؟ What land are we in? Then he said, ألست بالبلدة؟ Are you not in البلدة? By the way, one of the names of Mecca is البلدة. Many people don't know that. Mecca has many names. From the names of Mecca is Al-Balda. That's what Allah said in the ayah. إِنَّمَا أُمِرْتُ أَنْ أَعْبُدَ رَبَّ هَذِهِ الْبَلْدَ. يعني Mecca. Al-Balda is a name من أسمائي Mecca. And also from the names of Mecca is Ad-Dar. Okay, it's one of the names of Mecca. Mm-hmm. Sorry. Balda is a name of what? Mecca. And the name Ad-Dar is a name of Medina. One of the names of Medina is what? Ad-Dar. That's what Allah said in the ayah, وَالَّذِينَ تَبَوُوا الدَّارَ. Ad-Dar here is referring to what? It's referring to Al-Medina. So that's the name of Medina. So the Prophet ﷺ said, is this not Medina, Mecca? قُلْنَا بَلَا يَا رَسُولُ. We said, of course it is. Then the Prophet said, فَإِنَّ دِمَاءَكُمْ your blood, وَأَمْوَالَكُمْ and your wealth, وَأَعْرَاضَكُمْ and your honor, وَأَبْشَارَكُمْ and your flesh, عليكم حرام. It is haram from one another. كحرمة يومكم هذا. Like it's haram from you today. في شهركم هذا. Because this is a sacred month. You can't kill anyone. في بلدكم هذا. Like it's haram in killing anyone in Mecca. ألا أو people. هل بلغت. I have conveyed the message. قلنا نعم. We said you have, O Messenger of Allah. اللهم اشهد. Oh Allah, be my witness. What we take from this hadith is, the Sahabas, when they became doubtful about the issue of the day, whether it's today, what is it? And they became doubtful. They said, Allah wa Rasulu A'lam. And today we have people who, when they're asked about religion related to a question related to the religion, if they have a slight doubt, instead of saying, Allah wa Rasulu A'lam. I'm Allahu A'lam. Instead of saying, Allahu A'lam. I have a bit of doubt, I don't know, I'll look into it. Allahu A'lam. What do they say? The answer is straight away. They what? The answer is straight away. Then the messenger said, لا ترجعوا بعدي كفارا. Do not become disbelievers after me. يضربوا بعضكم رقاب بعض. He's smacking each other's necks. فلما كان. Pay attention to this. This is the last part of this hadith. فلما كان يوم حرق ابن الحضرمي, when it was the day where ابن الحضرمي was burnt alive. Who is this ابن الحضرمي that the narration mentioned? It's actually really shocking. All of the English translation I tried to look for this hadith, it doesn't actually mention this story. It only mentions the Prophet's wording. Even if you look at your translation, no one's actually sat down and translated this part of the hadith in English. So we will do it inshallah ta'ala from here. فَلَمَّا كَانَ when it was, يَوْمَ the day, حُرِّقَ ابْنُ الْحَضْرَمِ ابْنُ الْحَضْرَمِ is a tabi'i. His name is Abdullah ibn Amrin. Who is the person who burnt him alive? He was burnt alive by Jariyat ibn Qudama, ibn Malik ibn Zuhayr al-Sa'diyu. How did this happen? The way it happened was, remember the fitna that happened between Muawiyah and Ali ibn Abi Talib, sah? Muawiyah sent a man, and who? Muawiyah sent a man, and Ali sent a man. Ali sent Jariyat ibn Qudama, and ibn Hadrami, Muawiyah sent him. The man that was sent by Muawiyah was burnt alive by who? By the companion Jariyat ibn Qudama. He went into a fortress and he put fire on him and he killed him. And he, not only him, but he burnt a large number of people that were with him. This is the fitna that happened, brothers. Fitan. Large, great fitna happened. Ali ibn Abi Talib, when the fitna happened between him and Muawiyah, he was walking amongst the qatla, the people that were killed. And you know whose head he saw in the middle of two rocks? Talha ibn Ubaidillah, Ashar al-Mubashareen bil Jannah. One of the 10 that were promised Jannah alive. Are we all together, brothers? His head was smashed between two rocks and he cried. This is the fitna where it reached. Are we all together, brothers? ولذلك امرؤ القيس said, الفتنة أول ما تكون فتية تسعى لزينتها لكل جهول حتى إذا اشتعلت وشب ظلامها ولت عجوزا ذات حليل. The fitna, when it first happens, brothers, it looks attractive. It looks good. Everyone wants to jump on it. But when it turns away from the people, the real colors of fitna comes clear. There's big problems that happen. If you look at Islamic history, do not be the cause of anyone who ignites any fitna on any way, shape or form. Wallahi, social media, wallahi, a lot of people are going to be questioned yawmul qiyamah. Wallahi, many people are going to come yawmul qiyamah and they're going to be questioned for things that they said and things that they wrote and things that they posted. سَيُسْأَلُونَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. And any place that you endorsed, either a fitna you endorsed, and people died from that fitna, it is on your scale, أمام الله تعالى, the Day of Judgment. The millions and thousands that died will be on your scale. Even if you showed a sign of approval, it will be on your scale, the Day of Judgment. Be careful. Don't speak about these issues of fitna. When you see fitna, فَنْعَنْهُ, run away from it. Don't speak about it. You have no knowledge of it. There's going to be a day. ستقوم بين يدي الله تعالى. You're going to stand in front of Allah. ليس بينك وبين الله ترجمان. Between you and Allah, there is no lawyer. There's no lawyer. So fitan. Especially nowadays, you put something small and you say something very small and it seconds. It'll catch what? It'll catch fire. A person makes a rumor and people just start speaking about that rumor. SubhanAllah, why would he so and so? How do you know he did it? What made you know that he did it? هذا من الشائعات. صح? It's from what? الشائعات. Made up. You don't know where it came from. Who said it? This hadith, it has another benefit that we take from it as well. And I'm going to conclude with that last point, which is, if you look at the second last one that I mentioned, Ikrimah narrated from who? Ikrimah narrated from who? Ibn Abbas, right? لا ترتدوا بعدي كفارا يضرب بعضكم رقاب بعض. صح? Ikrimah narrating this from Ibn Abbas frees him from a false allegation that was put against Ikrimah. Some people accuse Ikrimah of being of the Madhab al-Khawarij, that he believed that the Murtakib al-Kabira, the person who does major sin, is a kafir. Does that make sense? Some people accused Ikrimah of that opinion, the student of Ibn Abbas. And he's free from that. And the evidence for that is the fact that he narrated this hadith from Ibn Abbas. That he narrated that and another hadith that's going to come to us as well, inshallah ta'ala. That makes it more clearer. I will stop there, inshallah ta'ala.